Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausen Pereira. The dual supply and demand shocks from the COVID-19 pandemic are expected to cause a global recession. In the last several weeks, global supply chains have been disrupted as workers are locked down, factories shut, and closed borders and terminals block supplies and cargo. Aggregate demand has collapsed. The pandemic threatens to usher in a phase of economic insularity through efforts at localization of supply chains and stricter immigration controls. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze how globalization is likely to be localized. Joining me on the program today are Dr. Arvind Virmani, Chairman, EGRO Foundation, Aruna Sharma, former Secretary, Government of India, and K.A. Badrina, Senior Journalist. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Dr. Virmani, I'd like to begin the program with you. Let's first try and analyze and try and understand if we are going to see a new era, really, as far as globalization is concerned, or for that matter, we're going to see the end of globalization as we know it.
Yeah, so the way I look at it is in terms of the trends which one has seen over the past 5 to 10 years, and then what is the effect of the pandemic on those trends and perhaps some other new trends. So first, let me start with the trend which was very clear after the global financial crisis of deglobalization, and this was reflected in the trade GDP ratio of the world. So world trade divided by world GDP took a sharp knockdown after having grown consistently and rapidly for something like 10 to 20 years. And this trend with some fluctuations has continued. And what the pandemic, in my view, is going to do is to make this trend surer and deeper, so that trend will become more firm, so to say. The second is a more recent trend, which was basically started by President Trump when he started imposing tariffs, and then in particular the tariff war with China, and that is in terms of supply chains. Now, we all recall that about 5 years, till 5 years ago or so, China was heralded as the manufacturer to the world. And what President Trump really did was to alert people or perhaps to try and think about diversification of supply chains out of China and into other competitive markets. You know, there's always a bit of inertia, and I think he broke that inertia. But this pandemic is going to create now a clear trend in that direction of diversifying out of supply chain into other countries. In this context, I would just like to mention our own case where for a couple of weeks, we were really scared that the APIs that we use for manufacturing drugs would be disrupted and we would have trouble with our medicines. I still recall a conversation with a former member, I don't want to name him, of the National Security Council, where he pointed out to this over-dependence on chemicals, but in a positive way, that it should induce good relations with China. I was skeptical then, and of course, I have been confirmed that this is actually going to accelerate the diversification of supply chains, particularly on those items which are monopolized by China. That part is very clear. And before I pass on to others, I want to mention here, and maybe you can come back to this issue, of how there is a scope, you know, because if we do import substitution unilaterally and adopt certain measures, other countries may take this negatively. I mean, not China, but other countries. So I think some kind of a cooperative approach, which I can elaborate on later, with other countries who are concerned, whether it's the USA, EU, Japan, who are concerned about this over-dependence on a single country for manufacturers, would be a useful subject for geo-economic discussions.
Absolutely. All right. So since we are talking about trends, Ms. Aruna Sharma, are we going to see a new era as far as self-reliance is concerned as well? I mean, is that what the countries are going to work towards in the near future? I mean, I'm taking cue from what Mr. Virmani just said about how there are countries around the world who are skeptical about the manufacturing hub of China. So are they going to move towards more self-reliance?
If you look at it, I analyze it this way. India, with 1.3 billion population, we are a big consumer country. So the world look at us as a consumer country. We have a potential of becoming a manufacturing hub for our own use, not so much export dependent to trigger off or have a base levels. We are doing quite well where we decided to go more for self-sufficiency, whether it was in the sector of steel or information technology, in terms of assembly line for the mobile phones or electronic goods. But then one has to realize that the world is an open forum, and even pre-COVID, every country was becoming a little more protectionist. So whether it was EU or whether it was US, everybody was becoming a little protectionist to ensure regular employment to their own people, to their own citizens. So under that scenario, it is very important that in whichever sectors we can be, and we can be very clearly on 8 to 10 sectors where we can be self-reliant, where we go for the mining, whether we go for the goods manufactured based on the minerals, whether we go for the infra constructions, which India is, of course, a low infra country, so we have a great potential. On fast-moving consumer goods, it's a very big challenge because our manufacturers over a period of time did not have a level playing field. And they became the traders instead of manufacturers. And in the sense, they found it easy to import from China or any place and then work upon it. So this is a challenge. It's a very big challenge. And then liquidity is becoming a problem for them. And when I said no level playing field, what is happening? Our credit is expensive, our taxes, too many taxes on them. So they are not competitive if we don't give them a little shelter, but it has to be WTO compliant. And I'll just like to add one point that by banning from one country is not going to help. There are other conduits. Like China is heavily investing in Indonesia and Vietnam and others. So you will have imports coming from there. So definitely it has to be a case by case. Like no commitment in an open forum like RCEP, which we did not do and was the right thing. As far as the sectors which I was studying upon was steel and textiles. So that these sectors definitely it would have hit us very, very badly in the whole process. So the scenario is not going to be like a free trade like RCEP. There will be checks and balances case by case. But then when you talk of self-reliance, we have to bring in a level playing field, especially after COVID. Fast-moving consumer goods, we have lost to the brand names completely. Like whether you start off from a soft drink to others. I mean, my generation knows Gold Spot and, you know, all those drinks. These are all disappeared from the market. So that is where it's a question that how we sort of work upon it and start manufacturing, giving them a boost. I strongly feel that there is a need to give them cheaper credits and lesser taxation, a one-point taxation, which is going to help them to trigger and move towards self-reliance. So in major commodities, that is the core sector, we can be self-reliant. Aluminium, we are capable of, steel, we are capable of, cement, we are capable of. We should go for it, no doubt about it. But then in electronics making, we have lost the race. We can't go for the chip, we have to import. But yes, we can graduate to have a motherboard. Then similarly, in fast-moving goods, we have to have a relook into the policy if we are seriously thinking of self-reliance.
All right. Okay, all right. So, you know, talking about some of the challenges, K. Badrinath, let's talk about what could possibly be some of the biggest challenges in ensuring complete self-reliance as far as we are concerned.
Self-reliance as a concept is very nice to embark upon. But can we do it or not is a big, big, big issue. Especially in certain sectors that Arunaji had pointed out, my guess is that despite all the challenges, we can still make a big headway in terms of achieving self-reliance in a big way. For instance, most of the mobile parts have been imported from China, and they are assembled across the country in different factories. It is not that these chips or these circuit boards cannot be made in India, barring a part or two, most of them can be manufactured here. Cost effectiveness, and in any case, our quality would be much, much better than what the Chinese have been offering us till date. So the challenges will definitely be there, but this should be seen as an opportunity for us to localize the supply chains, both raw ingredients as well as manufacturing capacity across the value chain. So if that is done, which can take a year or two, but it is doable. I'll give you a small example. For instance, we were thinking about how would we, get over non-availability of personal protection equipment and all that. DRDO came up with a few solutions. And immediately our innovators in Pune, Coimbatore and all these places picked them up. And today, countries as far as Belgium or elsewhere have been placing orders on these small startup companies. Either for, for example, you have to go for COVID testing, kiosks. They are being done easily out of Pune. And so the point I'm trying to make is that there will be challenges, there have been challenges, and my guess is that we should work towards self-reliance rather than, solely depend upon imports. I'm not talking about, substitution or any such thing. No, I'm talking about building inherent capacities within the country. And maybe perhaps, as Dr. Virmani was talking about, some kind of a cooperative alliance between like-minded countries where perhaps we can, exchange amongst ourselves and see if we can put together some kind of an alternative to China.
Right.
Because for the simple reason that unless this is done, you would not be able to break this monopoly which China has, studiously built up over the years. My guess is it is doable.
Okay, all right. Taking the discussion forward then, since we are here, Dr. Virmani, could inward-looking policies at the end of the day hurt global growth?
So the way to look at the issue, one part Badri has mentioned, the way I would look at it is that how does one build competitiveness? So one part of it has to be that we must recognize that there is a large part of the world which is free market and open. So I would just mention three big groups, which is USA, EU and Japan. So we have to have a policy which is more open and free with respect to these countries. But where countries are authoritarian, where they have all kinds of indirect means of protection, we all know which country we are talking about here. And those are things, I was involved in the India-China trade discussion. They have so many levers which they have used for the last 30 years, which nobody else, non-authoritarian governments cannot do. So we have to have this dual type of policy where we use openness with, let's say, EU, US and Japan to drive competitiveness. And on the other hand, support industries which like Madam mentioned, industries where we have to become more independent. I mentioned API. One can identify a whole bunch of other products where there's too much of a monopoly with one country and give certain types of limited protection. For 3 to 5 years. When we studied the original import substitution and all in countries across the world to see which was successful, what was really successful, it was limited, focused, and for a short time duration. When you get into this habit of going from one protection to another, then the whole system of competition collapses. And finally, I should mention beyond this, you also obviously, but it needs to be mentioned again and again, have to put in place policies which improve your competitiveness. And we come back to things like agriculture, where we should be competitive, but there are too many controls, external sector reforms, the export promotion zones, where you need to have a debureaucratized, have land and labor policies which are free and can compete with countries like China, where you know, and even Vietnam, which have no such restrictions, and so on. I mean, again, one can go into each of these policies.
Right. You know, since we are talking about policies, Ms. Sharma, and since we've seen the world go through a tough phase, and there's still a lot more to come, are we going to see new policies with communities at the heart?
Communities in the sense?
General communities, you know, societies, people, you know, people-centric policies going forward, which are very, very localized, because at the end of the day, the people are suffering the most.
Let me put it this way, that I have become now a strong votary of it, because I have analyzed the sectors we were very successful. You have to have a holistic approach. What is happening, we are coming with either knee-jerk or patchwork. And that is not realizing what ripple effect it is having in the others. So when we are looking at people-centric, you cannot have a labor-intensive kind of a scenario. With the COVID, we 200% sure that the industries are going to become more and more automated, more and more work from home kind of scenario is going to come. So every industry will become less labor-dependent when we are going ahead. Under this scenario, it is very important, and what Mr. Virmani very correctly said, focus on agriculture and value addition in the local areas. So like to give you an example, that if you are growing mint, to make menthol out of mint, you can do it locally. It need not travel long distance. And menthol can be purchased by pharmaceuticals or confectionery industry from there. So the wealth comes in the local. Similarly, you can do the sort of puring of many of tomatoes and everything locally. And then it can be done into a branded name, whatever you want to make out of it. So these kind of a thing of a step up value addition in the local area is going to trigger employment for those. And then skilling has to be very, very focused if we want to be competitive. Because, you know, like in steel, we were the first one to have this Make in India kind and ban the imports. But then it was like the buyer has to be 200% sure about the quality and pricing has to be competitive. So these two is going to apply to every material that we are talking about when we are giving a jump to that industry. And like very rightly said, that we have a capability to do it, completely capable. It's only we have to give an ecosystem, a holistic thing. They don't have to run from pillar to post. So starting from their raw material to their outlet of finished products, we have to plug all the holes and then ensure to give a trigger so that we create an employment for the local people, because we are a young country and we have to create employment for them. But it has to be a higher skilled if we want to be sustainable. It can't be just gitti udhare or saman dhore kind of things. Those things are going to disappear very, very soon. Very, very soon.
Right. Okay. All right. So since K. Badrinath, this is the aspect that I want to take forward with you. So what does it mean to be moving towards a less integrated world? Because, you know, Dr. Virmani also mentioned it in his opening remarks about how President Trump is very particular about those kind of aspects. You know, the U.S. has also temporarily halted immigration. So how do we need to brace for a situation like this?
There are two things. My guess is we need to prepare for a world where virtually China becomes the largest pole, despite being isolated globally, number one. Number two, you have seen across countries the foreign direct investment guidelines. From India to Germany, France, Spain, Australia, all of them have moved towards restrictive foreign direct investment kind of a situation. When I say restrictive FDI, I'm talking you must have to see it as anti-China for the simple reason most of the guidelines all over the world that are being attempted have been attempted against Chinese aggression. Ironical as it is that a very opaque communist regime under President Xi seems to have attempted at economic expansion when there is a huge, you know, global epidemic or end pandemic like coronavirus that has been unleashed from Wuhan province itself. So my guess is we need to prepare ourselves, brace up our power, revisit all our policies only to see and live in a world where China is the largest global producer of both products and services. At the same time, it becomes very, quote and unquote, very untouchable by many of the countries, including the ones in Europe or Africa or elsewhere. So there is an element of suspicion, there is an element of fear, there is an element of, anger that this huge human, suffering and pain is because of China. So that apart, when you come to the policies aspect, what I think we can do is, one, like maybe for next 2 to 3 years, we can set a target as to where all we can achieve self-reliance, efficiency, quality, as well as price competitiveness. Out of the 5,000 odd tariff lines that we have, we can identify easily the products, merchandise export, merchandise, manufacturing line, where we can actually bring in an element of, competition. And it is possible. It may be a very tortuous way of trying to build up these capacities. But we can do it. As I said, in very few weeks, we could find alternatives. For example, the railways have, transformed the entire old bogies into, moving hospitals where, coronavirus patients can be treated. If this can happen in few weeks, I guess it'll take a few months for us to stand up and say, look, we have arrived and we can do.
Okay, all right. So time to get closing comments now from all my guests with the best way forward, starting first with you, Dr. Virmani, and also let's analyze another aspect. Even if we move towards self-reliance, is there enough demand locally as well? That's an aspect that we need to look at too.
Yeah, so this brings me back to my initial comments, which is, as I said, so what we have to do is jointly identify those products where EU, US, India and Japan are over-dependent on one country, and then in some sense mutually parcel out so that there's general agreement that, okay, India would likely be more competitive in, for example, drug intermediates because we have a large drug industry and so on among ourselves. So there is mutual agreement. So if we do something related to those products, then US doesn't get very excited and start complaining and so on. So my suggestion would be first for ourselves, identify those we are interested in where we can be competitive and quality and all both participants have mentioned, and then discuss with the other countries and convince them that these are the n number of products. Why don't you guys do these 3/4 of the product? We will do these. And then let's mutually become less dependent on one country. So that is the way I would suggest that the Indian government proceed in the next year or so.
Okay. All right. Ms. Sharma, what's the best way forward?
Yeah, I'll say that we must build upon, like Mr. Badrinath very rightly said, on making a list where we ourselves are going to be a big consumer, because we have that big advantage and we can easily sort of work upon those, say, 20 sectors where we become self-reliant for our own need as well as in quality we are capable to touch upon the world market. And this is possible to do it in a very big number. And we can proceed upon it. So it could range from agriculture produce to core sectors to softwares to development agenda. Everywhere we can sort of spread it out, and these 30 lists, then in a holistic way you go for it and ensure that everything is provided for. They need not sort of again have multiforous instructions or too many rules to be read between the lines and everything. So if we do it, and we have proven it over a period of time, many we have islands of success. So we have to build upon those islands and really do very well as we are moving it. Then another thing, I would just like to make a mention that the world trade relations are definitely the our own country comes first attitude with everybody. So there will be has to be a strong vigilance when we are moving ahead. We built upon our own plus points as we are going ahead, but then we also don't have to be dependent on any country for even a parts or as we are moving ahead. Research has to be allowed. So I'll just make a mention in defense sector, electronics for defense, we are electronic manufacturing. We are capable. We are quite capable. But somehow the way we are doing it, we are more import dependent. So like this, you know, it is very important that we have to plan now for coming 5 years and we have to plan for 20 years by investing in the corresponding research and going ahead with it. So it is possible because India is a bright spot and emerging spot. So it is an opportunity, we should not lose it. We have lost many opportunities in past. Now it's high time, we can't afford to lose it.
All right. K. Badrinath, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Yeah, there are two things I would like to mention, Frank. One is before even initiating any kind of cooperation or alliance or global partnership, minus China, my guess is that we need to, prioritize more in terms of building our own capacities and, supporting policy frameworks. And second part is, as long as you are cost competitive and quality competitive, the world will come to you. Second part is there a demand or things like that? Well, you have a big domestic demand, domestic market itself to consume. Well, you can also export. It's not that, China, what has happened to China is a big lesson for all of us to learn. So the point I'm trying to say is that while we enhance our domestic consumption, expanding our global market footprint is going to be the biggest challenge, and it can be done. A lot of, reports have appeared that a lot of companies want to get out of China, and the biggest, possibilities that we can tap those companies which can move their manufacturing bases to India. If you recall, countries like Japan, who have created a separate fund, dedicated fund of $2.2 billion to help the 2,700 companies to move out of China to other more open, flexible, and transparent geographies. So if that needs to be done, perhaps we need to cash upon these opportunities along with meeting up the challenges. I guess right. We can do.
Okay, all right. So with that, we call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests. What's coming out of this discussion is that we need to have a long-term vision, focus on our strengths, identify some key sectors and give them a push. We are capable of achieving self-reliance if we have the right kind of policies and with the right kind of push forward is what the panelists are suggesting. With that, it's a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's it from me. See you again next time.